إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول في كتابه الحكيم من كان يريد العاجلة عجلنا له فيها ما نشاء لمن نريد ثم جعلنا له جهنم يصلاها مذموما مدحورا ومن أراد الآخرة وسعى لها سعيها وهو مؤمن فأولئك كان سعيهم مشكورا كلاً نمد هؤلاء وهؤلاء من عطاء ربك وما كان عطاء ربك محظوراً انظر كيف فضلنا بعضهم على بعض وللآخرة أكبر درجات وأكبر تفضيلاً وأشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين فصل اللهم على محمد وعلى آل محمد وعلى أصحاب محمد الطيبين الطاهرين الهداة المهديين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أحبتي في الله أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله حق تقاته فلقد قرب الرحيل وذهب بساعات العمر وأوقاته واعلموا أن ملك الموت قد تخطانا إلى غيرنا وسيتخطى غيرنا إلينا فلنتخذ حذرنا فليأخذ العبد من نفسه لنفسه ومن صحته لمرضه ومن غناه لفقره ومن حياته لموته فوالله ما بعد الدنيا من دار إلا الجنة أو النار فلا تغرنكم الحياة الدنيا ولا يغرنكم بالله الغرور إن الله عنده علم الساعة وينزل الغيث ويعلم ما في الأرحام وما تدري نفس ماذا تكسب غدا وما تدري نفس بأي أرض تموت إن الله عليم خبير العاقل أيها الأحبة من دان نفسه وعمل لما بعد الموت والعاجز من أتبع نفسه هواها وتمنى على الله الأماني فاتقوا الله عباد الله وحاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا وزنوا أعمالكم قبل أن توزن عليكم وتأهبوا للعرض الأكبر على الله يومئذ تعرضون لا تخفى منكم خافية أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد حذيفة بن اليمان صحابي of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said people used to ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم about good things and good deeds but I was different I was asking the Prophet about evil why? Because I was afraid to fall into it today I'm going to share with you a reminder for you and for myself about the mother of all evil about a sin that with it no good deed actually will be sound and maybe no good deed will be accepted. One of the most dangerous diseases of the heart, the reason behind corruption in planet Earth and in society, the reason behind wars, the reason behind even problems and divisions inside communities and families, even the reason sometimes that a brother would not speak to his brother for 5 years or even more. In Sahih Muslim, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, and this hadith was narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu wa ardah, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, لا يدخل الجنة. He is not going to be admitted into paradise. Who ya Rasulullah? He said, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من كبر. Anybody who has a mustard seed worth of arrogance in his heart. Arrogance is a killer. Arrogance corrupts the human being's heart. Arrogance is a reason. On the day of judgment, some people will not have the condition of success. What is the condition of success on the day of judgment? Listen to it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he said about that day, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالُ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. On that day, money and fame and family is not going to benefit you except those who will come to Allah with a sound heart, a pure heart. Imagine your heart, a cup of milk, contaminated with some water. Yes, the water is a contaminant when it comes to milk. You wouldn't like to buy milk from the supermarket, half milk, half water. But still, if you have a cup of milk and I pour some water into it, you will still be able to drink it. If I pour some orange juice into it, you will be able to drink it. But imagine your heart, a cup of milk, and I put a drop of blood in it. Who is willing to drink it now? That's exactly what a drop of arrogance will do to the heart of the believer. And arrogance is different types. Some of the types of arrogance actually will prevent forever entering Jannah on the Day of Judgment. Those who are actually too arrogant to believe that La ilaha illallah. Those who are too proud to say Allah is one, Allah is my creator. This type of arrogance is actually a shortcut to hellfire forever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about those in the Quran, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا إِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. When you tell them لا إله إلا الله, they're too arrogant, too proud to accept it. In the same surah, in Surah As-Saffat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them that on the day of judgment, it will be told to them, إِنَّكُمْ لَذَائِقُ الْعَذَابِ الْأَلِيمِ وَمَا تُجْزَوْنَ إِلَّا مَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. You will taste punishment today because of such arrogance. There is also another type of arrogance, which is people who are too arrogant to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe that Allah exists. They believe that He is the creator, but they're too arrogant to worship Him. And notice that when I say worship Him here, I don't mean only to pray for Him, because there is a distinction between worship as a general term and salah. And prayer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Taha, in Surah Taha, He tells Musa alayhi salam, إِنِّي أَنَ اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدْنِي وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. I am your Lord, no God but me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that about Himself, and He is ordering Musa, worship me and pray for me. So look at the way He is saying it. Salah, right, is part of the worship. But the worship is much bigger than that. If you go to the word ibadah in the Arabic tongue and you go to the root of it, it comes from the word abada. Abada, yu'abbidu, ta'ni tawwa'a, yutawwi'u, means to obey. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْإِنسَ وَالْجِنَّ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have created the jinn and the ins, but to obey me, to obey what I ordered. And if the purpose of our existence, which is to obey Allah, someone will be too arrogant to do that, what do you think his situation will be on the Day of Judgment? Allah said in the Quran, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Your parents, you have to do ihsan to your parents. It's as equivalent as believing or thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ إِلَيَّ الْمَصِيرُ. But some people are too cool to be good to their parents. They know that they have to be good to them, but they're too proud to go and, you know, give their mom the hug, or, you know, visit their mom, or do whatever is needed to their mothers and their fathers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. Do not bite back one another. Some people, he knows while he's backbiting that he is wrong, and he's doing istighfar, and he knows that this is a bad thing in his life. That is not an arrogant human being. When you admit your sin, you're not arrogant. But those whom you tell them, brother, you're backbiting your brother. Wallahi, one of them said, oh, I can say that in front of him. Well, that makes it halal. Don't be too proud to admit that this is a sin. Obey Allah. Those who are too arrogant to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there will be punishment for them in the Day of Judgment. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this arrogance will block Jannah, will prevent them from entering Jannah on the Day of Judgment. A lot of people, unfortunately, they have this in themselves. They know that this arrogance, when it comes to obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, it will destroy their life. It will spoil their deen. But still, they actually continue to do that. Of course, The arrogance is available in the hearts of a lot of people, but in different levels. And some, or the vast majority of us, if you ask us, are you arrogant, brother? Do you have any arrogance in your heart? The answer definitely will be, oh, of course not, brother. No, I don't have it. We are too proud sometimes even to admit. But you know what? There are tests. There are signs. There is a lot of signs for arrogance, but I'm going to share with you some of the signs. Maybe one of us will feel that, okay, this is in me. I got to change that. I got to save myself on the day of judgment. You know, one of the hints, if someone is an arrogant, he says, I too much when he talks. You'll find that the vast majority of his speech is about himself. Open any topic in the world, he will rotate it and bring it back and talk about himself. Ana, I or me, is a very dangerous word to be said. Can you imagine once I listened to a khutbah on the internet, actually, an imam on a pulpit spent the whole khutbah talking about himself. He's too proud of himself. You are in a masjid of Allah. You are a Muslim. Remember, you live among people that are equal to you, and sometimes they might be even better than you. Talking about yourself is a trap. مَادِحُ نَفْسِهِ كَذَّابُ, as the Arabs said. The Arabs, they used to say, the one who praises himself is a liar. I say, مَادِحُ نَفْسِهِ مُتَكَبِّرُ. The one who praises himself is arrogant. Another sign of arrogance is بَطَرُ الْحَقِّ. كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, الكبر, and this is in Sahih Muslim, الكبر بطر الحق, to ignore the truth. He knows that this side is on the truth and this side is in falsehood. Although he knows that, he sides with the side that is on the falsehood. He knows that he is wrong, but he debates and he discusses, and he is not willing actually to accept your point of view. You differ with him, he drops you from his life. Some of them, they became too arrogant. You differ with him, he renders you a kafir. Another sign of arrogance is he does not accept advice. He does not accept advice even if it is in the deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about those, especially when he's doing a big sin and you tell him, Ittaqillah, have taqwa of Allah. The real muttaqi, he will say, Allahumma ja'alni min al-muttaqeen. Ya Allah, make me of those who have taqwa. The one with arrogance, he will tell you, did I say kufr? Why are you telling me attaqillah? He will debate that. Listen to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala document this in the Quran. He said, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُ اتَّقِ اللَّهُ أَخَذَتْهُ الْعِزَّةُ بِالْإِثْمِ. When you tell him attaqillah, he's too proud, he's too arrogant. Even in sin, he is too arrogant. With all due respect, sometimes in the masajid, and I see that sometimes, you know, the brothers and the sisters, you hear them talking in the back during the Friday khutbah. Do you think that there is a Muslim now on the face of the planet who does not know that in the khutbah of Salat al-Jum'ah, you're not supposed to be talking to the one who's beside you? Any Muslim on the face of the planet, you know, does not know that you're not supposed to be texting during the khutbah? Wallahi, in one of the khutbahs, the phone rang and the brother answered the phone. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, مَنْ مَسَّ الْحَصَى فَقَدْ لَغَى وَمَنْ لَغَى فَلَا صَلَاةَ لَفَلَا جُمْعَةَ لَهُ. If you play with something, if you distract yourself from the Jum'ah, there is no Jum'ah for you. You left your work, you left your home, and some of you drove maybe a long distance and came here, and you spend all this time in the masjid, right? And you spoil that simply because you want to answer a text message or a phone call, or you talk to a brother or a sister in the masjid and distract them. So instead of getting the ajr, you might be getting even or committing a sin when you speak or you make others speak or distract them during Salat al-Jum'ah. Those who do not know, we teach them. Because sometimes we have new Muslims. Brothers, could you come closer, please? It's getting crowded in the back. Jazakumullah khair. See, even this, by the way, sometimes we tell people, come closer. You'll find someone, he's sitting in the middle and there is space in front of him and he doesn't want to move. Brother, it's good. Wallahi, there are rewards in it. There are hasanat. We came to this masjid today to worship Allah and to get more hasanat. So let's be lenient. Let's be easy to deal with. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us the barakah in our salah today here in this masjid. Those who do not know, we teach them. But those who knows, we remind them. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders in the Quran, what did he say? He said, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind them. For reminder benefits who? The true believers. Those who don't want to obey, Deal with it. Deal with it, wal'ayadu billah. Another sign of arrogance, he never says sorry. He never admits that he was wrong and he apologizes for what he has done. Although the Prophet ﷺ said, كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَّى. All of us, we make mistakes. All of us, no exception. Every single human being on the face of the planet will make mistakes, except those whom Allah has prevented them or protected them from making mistakes. Like Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the deen, he would never make a mistake. Why? Because Allah asamahu. Allah protected him. But you and I are just human beings. We forget. And we get angry, and we get hungry, and we get distracted, and we make mistakes. Nothing wrong with, I apologize, brother, I have made a mistake. Another sign of arrogance is, he loves to be praised. Oh, he is so addicted to it. Some people, they will hire you because you're praising them too much. Some people, actually, they will love to be praised for things that they did not do. One of the brothers in one of the communities, I built the Islamic school 25 years ago, although he came to the community 15 years ago. See, brother, I mean, why? Why do you want to be praised for something that you did not even do, or you were not even there when it happened? That's a sign from, you know, of arrogance in him. He's too proud. His pride sometimes is thirsty for satisfaction or the satisfaction of praise from other people. Another sign of arrogance is غمط الناس كما قال المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم في صحيح مسلم الكبر أو من الكبر غمط الناس, which means that you look down to people. Why? Because he has so much self-admiration. He has so much pride in himself that he starts looking down to people, and this is the root of arrogance. That's how it starts. It starts actually with looking at his success, looking at the blessings of his life. And he will talk about it first with himself. He will tell himself that this business is so successful because I'm so shrewd. Because I'm so intelligent. My skills, my information, my connections, I'm a whiz in business. That is why I am a very successful businessman. Notice that he's referring his success to whom? To himself. He forgets that the one who gave him that is Allah. There are people who are smarter than you, working harder than you, but they're not making even 10% of your income. They do not have even 10% of your success. Why do you think is that? Fitna. Test from Allah. He granted you the success. Are you going to refer the success and the ni'mah to yourself, or are you going to refer it to Allah? Are you going to use this ni'mah to actually look down to people, or are you going to be thankful to His Majesty that He has given that to you? All of you know about a creature from the jinn who actually was a worshipper among the angels, but he has fallen so down, so low, because of this particular thing. He admired himself so much, he compared himself with someone else, and he found out that, oh, I'm better than him. وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. We told the angels, bow for Adam, make sujood, prostrate for the creation of Adam. All of them, they made sujood except Iblis. You know the story in details. He refused. He was too arrogant. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, قَالَ مَا مَنَعَكَ أَلَّا تَسْجُدَ إِذْ أَمَرْتُكَ. Why didn't you prostrate when I ordered you? قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْ. I'm better than him. See, that's a killer. I'm better than him. And sisters, sometimes they use that. I'm better than her. قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْ. خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ. You created me from fire. And you created him from mud, from clay, from dust. So I am better than him. Why? Because the fire is better than the mud. Well, who created you from the fire? Is that something that you have achieved on your own? Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given it to you? Some people, they're too proud of themselves. I'm white, blonde hair, blue eyes, and he is black or brown or red or yellow. Who gave you that actually? I'm too proud, my family is so and so and his family is not. I'm too proud, I'm from Pakistan, he's from that country. Well, who actually allowed you to be born in Pakistan? He honored you by that. You should be appreciative of that. Instead of seeing yourself better than the rest of the people. I'm not saying that people from Pakistan are arrogant. They're amazing. Actually, a lot of them are too humble. May Allah bless their hearts. But the idea is, all those blessings that Allah has given you, He has given it to you. Why in the world would you take something that Allah has given to you and you will use it to be arrogant and to look down at people? Wallahi, if you are from the family of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, min alil bayt, wallahi lan yughniya anka shay'an yawm al-qiyamah. It's not going to benefit you on the day of judgment. The Prophet told Fatima, his daughter, la ughni anki shay'a, I'm not going to benefit you on the day of judgment. She's the daughter of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Fatima al-Tahira. She's an amazing, amazing woman. And inshallah, she will be in al-Firdaws al-A'la. But he told her, although you are my daughter, I'm not going to benefit you on the day of judgment. Listen to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all of you have heard this hadith before. In Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, he said alayhi salatu wa salam, la fadla li arabiyyin ala a'jami. No benefit, no levels. If you are an Arab and someone is not an Arab, that is not actually something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take into consideration on the day of judgment. The black is not better than the white, and vice versa. The man is not better than the woman, and vice versa. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The best of you in the sight of Allah are the most righteous. Those who have taqwa the most. And you know what? Do you see taqwa? The thing that distinguishes us in the sight of Allah is hidden. No one sees it except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the one that you look down to, he could be better than you. Iblis has made a major mistake. He has looked at the box, the outside, and he did not understand the value of Adam and who Adam is. Imagine if I give you a box, a carton box, 2 inches by 2 inches, and I give it to you, it's empty. 50 cents downtown, you can buy it from there. And you lose that box. Would you feel bad about it? Maybe you'd feel bad that, you know, the Sheikh gave me this box and lost it, but because of the value of it, you're not going to feel bad because you lost 50 cents. But imagine now, if before I gave you the box, I put in it a 50 carat VVS diamond. $10 million value. It's like this size, half an inch by half an inch. Put it in the box and give it to you. And now you lost the box. What's going to happen to you? You're going to flip. Why? Because the value of the box now is so precious. It is not the carton box that is outside. It's what's inside the box. Iblis has made that mistake. He looked at the mud that Adam was created from, and he did not look at the ruh that Allah has blew into Adam. That's what made Adam honorable. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. When we honored Bani Adam, we honored them because we blew this breath of the soul, the honorable soul from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala into Adam. فَأَبْلَسَ إِبْلِيسِ. Do you know what Iblis means? Iblis is an Arabic word. And who called Iblis? Iblis Allah. Iblis in the Arabic tongue comes from أَبْلَسَ, means, you see, there is a word that's close to it, which is aflasa. Aflasa means he is bankrupt, right? Bankrupt means that he lost his money. But ablasa means that he has lost everything. His money and his health and his, you know, status. And he has lost everything. Dunya wa akhirah. Ablasa Iblis because he has made such a mistake. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجعلنا من المتواضعين. نبينا صلى الله عليه وسلم كان عبدا وكان فخورا بذلك. He was a slave صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he was so proud that he was a slave. All of us, we should learn from him صلى الله عليه وسلم. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه لعلكم ترحمون. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. إمام البيهقي narrates a hadith on behalf of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said that three deadly sins, ثلاث مهلكات, شح مطاع. The human self is stingy by its nature. So the one who will follow his stinginess and will be a miser, will not donate في سبيل الله, will not spend في سبيل الله, that is a very dangerous thing to do. That is a deadly sin. Another one, hawan muttaba, the desires, the one who follows his own desire. That's a sin also that will actually be deadly on the day of judgment. And ijabul mar'i bi nafsi, and self-admiration or pride. The Sahaba actually, they have fallen into this in Hunayn. In the battle of Hunayn, the Sahaba looked around and they found that there are 12,000 Sahabi. Remember in Badr and Uhud, in Al-Ahzab, how many they were? 300, 700, 950, right? Now there are 12,000. One of the Sahaba said, لَن نُغْلَبَ الْيَوْمَ مِنْ قِلَّةِ. Today we're not going to be defeated because of low numbers. What happened to them? Listen from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah At-Tawbah, he said, وَيَوْمَ حُنَيْنٍ إِذْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ كَثْرَتُكُمْ فَلَمْ تُغْنِ عَنْكُمْ شَيْئًا وَضَاقَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْأَرْضُ بِمَا رَحُبَتْ ثُمَّ وَلَّيْتُمْ مُدْبِرِينَ. On that day, the numbers that you were leaning on, it did not benefit you. You ran away from the battlefield. So the reason for success all the time and the favors is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Notice the difference between Hunayn and Badr. قال الله تبارك وتعالى, in Badr actually there were how many? There were 300, and the army of the mushrikeen was 1,000. Listen to what Allah said in the Quran. He said, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّ. Allah has granted you the victory in Badr, and you were humble. You were in humility. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ فِيرَ اللَّهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. It is really a horrible thing when you start actually feeling proud of the ni'mah. Because that's where it starts. I'm too proud, and then I compare myself with others, and I find myself better than them in that thing, and then I become arrogant, and then I say, أنا خير من, I'm better than him, the way Iblis has said that about Adam, and then I do kufr bin ni'mah. I do kufr bin ni'mah means what? أنا كافر now. I am a kafir of the favors of Allah, of the ni'mah of Allah. I'm not kafir that Allah exists. No, no, no. This ni'mah, I am kafir that it's from Allah. I am relating this ni'mah to me. You all read Surah Al-Kahf, and you know the story of the two men in Surah Al-Kahf, the one that has the two gardens and the one that has nothing, right? He was too proud. قال أنا, I have more money than you, and I actually think that the day of judgment is not coming, and if the day of judgment is gonna come, I will get even better than this. His friend is advising him, you are committing kufr of the ni'mah of Allah. He did not listen. He said, if you enter your Jannah, وَلَوْلَا إِذْ دَخَلْتَ جَنَّتَكَ قُلْتَ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ. If you say this is by the will of Allah, لَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. There is no strength or ability except by Allah. That's how you get to keep the ni'mah. That's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless the ni'mah, you know, in your life. But he didn't do that. What happened to him? قَالَ اللَّهُ وَأُحِيطَ بِثَمَرِهِ. He destroyed his Jannah. Qarun was a very rich man. He came out to his people with the zina. You know what happened to Qarun? All of you. He said, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. I have this because of my own doing, of my own intelligence, of my own abilities and skill. What happened to him? قَالَ اللَّهُ فَخَسَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِهِ الْأَرْضِ. Sinkhole, him and his money and his house. A drop of arrogance will prevent, will block Jannah. So the challenge is not, you know, whether I have less of it. No, no, no. The challenge is to purify my heart totally of it. So what do I do to work on this? What do I do to treat it if it's in me? Two things. Ilmun wa amal. Knowledge and action. The knowledge is fa'lam wa ma bikum min ni'matin fa min Allah. All the time, any ni'mah that you have, it doesn't matter what kind of favor in your life, refer it to His Majesty. Praise His Majesty for it. Thank His Majesty for it. Don't use it to disobey His Majesty. Allah will bless it and will keep it in your life and will reward you for it even more on the Day of Judgment. And when it comes to action, read the Quran. It will reduce the arrogance in your heart. Remember death. It will reduce the arrogance in your heart. Remember the Day of Judgment when you stand before His Majesty to answer for every single thing that you have done. It will reduce the arrogance in your heart. Read the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It will teach you, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ. You actually have a role model in the Prophet, so it teaches you how humble he was. If Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who has all the reasons to be proud, he was so humble. What about me? I mean, I have to be so humble and so down to earth all the time to be a true follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And finally, break it. Break yourself inside if it actually talks to you or entices you or tells you that you're better than other people. I'm going to conclude with a 1 minute scene that touched my heart long time ago. The son of Sheikh Muhammad Mitwalli Sha'rawi has told us a story about his own father. Many of you who are in the Middle East, they know Muhammad Mitwalli Sha'rawi. He was one of the Mufassirin of the Quran, rahmatullahi alayhi. He was a great imam. Once his son drives him to a convention. The convention is filled with young Muslims. After he finished his speech and came out of the convention, he entered his car. He was an old man. He entered his car and they picked up his car. The young men who are, you know, who came out of the convention, they were so strong, and so many of them, and they loved him so much. They wanted to greet him. They wanted to praise him. They surrounded his car, and then they picked up his car, and they walked with it for a while. And then they convinced him to put it down. His son got into the car and drove away. In the middle of the way home, Sheikh Sha'rawi told his son, stop right here in front of that masjid. He said, why? He said, I want to do something in the masjid and come back. Wait for me here. And he went inside. The man was waiting for his dad to come back. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes. He got so worried. His dad is old and sick. So he went inside the masjid to look for him. He looked for him in the musalla. He did not find him. So he said, maybe he went to make wudu in one of the bathrooms and fell down there. So he goes and he hears noise in one of the bathrooms. He opens the bathroom. He finds Sheikh Muhammad Mutawalli Sha'rawi cleaning the floor of the bathroom with his own abaya. He said, Dad, what are you doing? Khala haddathatni nafsi. Myself, when they left the car, talked to me. I felt some pride, so I wanted to break it and to remind it who is my soul, who's my nafs is. I wanted to remind myself that I am nothing. I'm just a sperm who started this life, and I'm gonna end up a body that will be rotting under the ground. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين اللهم اهد شباب المسلمين وبنات المسلمين فرج هم المهمومين ونفس كرب المكروبين واقض الدين عن المدينين اللهم اشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم فرج عن إخواننا المسلمين في كل بقاع الأرض إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله العظيم الجليل يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم واسألوه من فضله يؤتكم وقوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمني وإياكم الله
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
استووا واعتدلوا straighten your lines and fill in the gaps and please make sure that your cell phone is turned off جزاكم الله خير الله أكبر بسم الله الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فسجدوا إلا إبليس فسجدوا إلا إبليس كان من الجن ففسق عن أمر ربه أفتتخذونه وذريته أولياء من دوني وهم لكم عدو بئس للظالمين بدلا ما أشهدتهم خلق السماوات والأرض ولا خلق أنفسهم وما كنت متخذ المضلين عضدا ويوم يقول نادوا شركائي الذين زعمتم فدعوهم فلم يستجيبوا لهم وجعلنا بينهم موبقا ورأى المجرمون النار فظنوا أنهم مواقعوها ولم يجدوا عنها مصرفا ولقد صرفنا في هذا القرآن للناس من كل مثل وكان الإنسان أكثر شيء جدلا
الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات كانت لهم جنات الفردوس نزلا خالدين فيها لا يبغون عنها حولا. قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنفد البحر قبل أن تنفد كلمات ربي ولو جئنا بمثله مددا. قل إنما أنا بشر مثلكم يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد، فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.